I'm here with Jake E.F. Cyhra to talk about their latest record, the Vertigo Trigger, out August 18th on Nuclear Blast. It's always a pleasure to talk to you. It's always a pleasure to have you on the channel. Thank you very much for taking the time.
Thank you for having me. And wasn't it so that one of your absolute first interviews ever was with me?
Yeah, the first, not the first interview, but the first in-person interview. We did it at the show when you guys were on tour with Sabaton. We met at the venue at the Phoenix. I remember like if it was today. And you were so kind with your time, and we've been friends ever since. So it was great.
I remember your son, he was just like 3 apples high, and now he's like 55 apples high. It's weird.
He's sitting on a carton of apples.
Exactly.
Yeah, it's, he makes us look like midgets, all of us. That's how how tall he is. He's massive.
I mean, like you are a pretty tall guy. How come he got taller than you?
I don't know. Somewhere in the genes. I did one of those DNA tests to find out where my genes are from. I have like 3% Norwegian, so he must have some tall Norwegian descendants in his blood, some Vikings in his blood, where that's why he's that tall.
How tall is the mailman?
He's shorter than me, so I think we're safe on that. I had to think for a minute there, and I'm like, yeah, no, he's shorter than me.
My daughter actually asked my wife that when she was like 2-3 years old. She had just learned to speak, and she said that, is daddy coming home today? And I just went out on tour. I had been gone for like 3 days, and I was going to be away for 6 more weeks. And mommy said, no, he's not. He's on tour. Okay, does the mailman come today?
I don't know if she did that as a joke, but I love her sense of humor.
Yeah, exactly. I don't think that she understood what she was saying, but yeah.
So let's talk about the Vertigo Trigger. And let me start off by asking you this. How was the journey from No Halos in Hell to this album? Was it a smooth journey? Was it a smooth transition for you guys to go from one record to the next?
I would say that it started out so well with the No Halo in Hell album. We got, you know, tour offer after tour offer. We went on tour with Battle Beast. We went on tour with Delane. We had so many things in pipeline. And then all of a sudden, the pandemic hit. And it just sucked. It actually drew all energy out from my body. And for the first year of the pandemic, I was just lying still, sitting in the sofa, playing Call of Duty. And I was just like, I couldn't focus on music really, because it was someone just pulled the rug under my feet. It was actually terrible. And then when we finally realized that, okay, we should probably make music, I was actually looking at all the other bands that were, you know, they continued on like nothing had happened. They were doing these online live events, and they were releasing new music and whatever. But I thought from the beginning that I did not want to release new music that possibly were not tourable, if that makes sense. I didn't want to release an album in the middle of the pandemic, and then the pandemic would be ongoing, and then you would have to make yet another album, and then that album in between would just be forgotten. So it took me almost a year to, you know, realize that, okay, we need to start writing music. And then we're talking with Jacob Hansen, that we always go and record with. And it was hard for us living in 3 different countries to, you know, come to Denmark in the middle of the pandemic. Even though all of us were vaccinated, it was still, you know, like so many restrictions and, you know, mumbo jumbo. So we just decided to actually record and produce the album by ourselves in our studios, which was hard in the beginning, but then we, you know, found the pace. And I'm actually really happy that we did that, because all of a sudden, we, instead of renting a studio for 8 weeks or 6 weeks, we had a year where we could, you know, just write, produce, rearrange, mix, remix, whatever, until we found the songs and the titles that we really wanted to have. So that was really nice.
Is your vision for the band changed over time? Is the vision, when you guys released your debut record, the vision that you had at that point, is it still the same vision that you have today?
Absolutely. I mean, like when me and Jesper founded the band from the beginning, we just wanted to make music that we would listen to ourselves. And we wanted to make something that we could have a fun time with. And we, of course, wanted to, you know, whenever you start a new band, you always want to become the biggest band in the world, right? At least that's your intention in your mind and your mindset. But first and foremost, we wanted to create a band that were a band of brothers. So that's why we recruited Alex and Oige and Peter in the beginning, and then now also Marcus. We've never had an argument and a fight, and you know, everything's very, very smooth, and we're having a killer time when we're together and when we're touring, and that's what we want to continue on. Music-wise, I don't think that music has changed dramatically since the first album. I mean, like, it's a natural progression on how a band evolved, I must say. But if anyone have never heard Cyhra, they start with the Vertigo Trigger and then listen to Letters to Myself, I would think that they would completely recognize themselves in the music landscape.
Yeah, I think there's definitely been an evolution, but without completely breaking path of where you guys were across each and every single record. I think it's easy to see the red line between all three albums, in all honesty. Now, you mentioned that you guys did the production yourselves. Was that difficult to take that step and to ensure that you would get the end results that fans would expect from you guys?
I mean, first of all, I have a professional studio. I write so many songs for so many bands. I produce so many bands, but there has always been this thing with me where when I do things myself, I appreciate to have someone next to me that tells me that now it's good enough, or this is fantastic, or, you know, we should take one more take, or you could try that angle or whatever. You know, that role that I always have when I produce other bands. Now I had to do all the job, all the work myself. And I also had to be the guy telling myself, yeah, this is good enough. So that was probably the hardest thing in the beginning, you know, to find that middle ground on, like, okay, how much shall I push myself? When is it enough? When is it not enough? You know, how much should I let through? And you know, that is always harder. It's always easier to have someone like Jacob Hansen next to you saying that, nope, now we go on to the next song. So that was probably the hardest thing.
You mentioned at the start of the band, you and Jesper had the vision of creating a band that you guys wanted to sound like the bands that you would want to listen to. How is it working with someone like Jesper?
I mean, I've always said this in so many interviews. I mean, like, me and Jesper, we've been really, really close friends for more than 20 years now. I mean, I started out as a pyro technician for In Flames back in the days, and we instantly became friends. But it took us 15 years from that moment in time where we actually started to create music together. But I remember the first couple of shows and tours we did with Cyhra, and I was standing there singing, and I looked to my right, and there's Jesper Strömblad, the guy that I grew up with, the guy that whose album changed me into becoming the writer that I am today. I mean, like, his music has inspired me so much, and all of a sudden I have to pinch my arm because, like, I'm sharing the stage with one of my biggest idols, even though he's one of my closest friends. You know, like, it's funny, but it's still like that sometimes.
When it came to this album, from a lyrical standpoint, how was this record for you? Did the pandemic impact this record? Did your state of mind of playing Call of Duty every single day in your underwear impact the lyrical content on this record?
I never told you that I wore underwear. Well,
that's true. That was on my part. It's true.
No. Absolutely. I've been battling with death anxiety since I was just a little kid, and it has been something that has been triggering me from time to time. It's come in waves. It, you know, it has come and it has disappeared, and I have, like, some.
I lost your audio.
Someone called me on the landline. It's been coming towards me in waves, and it has disappeared and it's come back and whatever. During the pandemic, it struck me like a fucking tornado and or a tsunami. I usually never go deep into like my own feelings when I write lyrics. I usually write about things that people can relate to, but it does not necessarily have to do with my own feelings. And but on this album, I really opened up, and there's most of the songs is something that I feel myself, and you know, I'm trying to send a message to people, and you know, share what I've been going through and what I go through, and I know that I'm not alone in these kind of feelings. So yeah, it's a self-made or self what do you say self-described kind of album in that sense. I can't find any better word for it right now.
We talked off the record when I got the album and I was listening to it. You actually sent me a message about something, and I was actually listening to the album as I got your message. And I said to you right away that this is your strongest album vocally since starting the band. And you're like, oh, I didn't do anything differently. And I'm like, I don't know what, like, don't ask me. I don't know what you did, but you sound better than ever on this album. Like, this is the best vocal performance by you by far. And I'm not saying that the other ones weren't good, but this one stands out. Have you had a chance after we had that conversation to think a little bit about maybe what has created this incredible vocal performance by you on this album?
Mm-hmm. First of all, I'm humble that you say these words, because that means everything to me to have that praise. But honestly, I don't know what I did differently. Maybe I had more time. Maybe I could focus more on details and nuances that I couldn't do before. When you, as I told you before, you rent a studio for 6-8 weeks, and you know, you have to be done when the deadline is there. But maybe I, first of all, I don't hear it myself. I just hear me, but it's really nice to hear that someone else says that, yeah, this is better than before, because then you're progressing in the right direction. And also, I'm getting older. Usually singers, you know, tend to just get worse and worse. I mean, like that is a good sign for me, but maybe I just had more time to, you know, focus on things, and you know, try out different takes in different ways. Maybe that is the fact, or maybe it's just that I became way better. I don't know.
Well, one song that showcases my point of view is Ashlight. Your vocals on that song are outstanding. Like the way you take that song towards the end, as you reach the pinnacle, the climax of the track, I was like, wow, this is unreal. First of all, it's such a great song, musically, vocally, lyrically, but your performance on it really elevates it. Where does that track stand for you, and what does that track represent for you from a vocal standpoint?
From a vocal standpoint, I tried to do something different on that track. It was actually, I think it was the first song that we did, or I did. That is one of the songs that I more or less did myself, and I was experimenting a lot with some new keyboards, some new background, some new you know, sounds in general, and also I tried to make the song in a way that I wanted to add a feeling that we hadn't done before, a little bit more melodramatic, but still not like proggy in any way. But you know, I was thinking a little bit like film scoring in the beginning of the intro and the verse thing, and then the ending, the end part of the song comes from that. I felt that this song needs something else, and then I was thinking about Michael Kiske when he did these add-ons for some of the Aventasia songs that he guested on. I think it was like the second Aventasia album or something like that. So I was inspired by him, and that is the outcome of it when you hear the song.
I messaged you about this track because I had a great idea. I think we need to do this. We need to do a parody of this song, but call it Flashlight.
Flashlight.
Yeah, I think it's a genius idea. You know, you may not agree with me, but I think it needs to happen. So whenever you have some...
We have to do that. We have to do that. But first you need to convince my wife, I guess.
Yes, maybe it'll be a hard sell for her, but I think once she sees the finished product, I think she'll be convinced.
Yeah, but you need to sing it.
Need to sing it. Wow. Okay. Now you're putting me on the spot. You know what? Maybe I'll take some during my vacation this summer. I'll write the. You know what? Before I sing it, I'll write the lyrics for it, and I'll send you the lyrics. And then if
do that. Yeah.
And then I if think you're that is cool with idea. The lyrics, then I'll attempt to sing at least a verse or a chorus or something.
Yeah, we should totally do that, and I can edit your vocals so that you sound fantastic.
All right, sounds great. Okay, so we have a deal. I'm super excited about this now. and I have to ask you mentioned Michael Kiske. Is he your biggest vocal influence?
He was when I grew up, absolutely. I mean, like, I started to listen to him when I was 5-6 years old, and I was amazed already back then. He's actually the only person in Halloween that I've never met. I know most of the guys in the band nowadays, but he is a secretive kind of guy, and I've never had the chance to meet him. So I think that is a good thing as well, because he has meant so much for my own progression when it comes to being a vocalist. So that is good. But he was absolutely the first. But then, you know, there has been many along the way. I mean, like, Geoff Tate was the second one. Then it was Rob Halford, Joachim Kahns, Roy Kahn, so many other singers that have influenced me in so many ways. The latest one that has influenced me most, I think, is Ed Sheeran. Maybe not vocally, but how he writes music, because I think he's a genius when it comes to that.
Wow, I was not expecting to hear that.
Yeah, absolutely. I listen to all kind of music. You know, even though I'm a metalhead, when I hear a good song, it's a good song. It doesn't matter if it's death metal, black metal, or Ed Sheeran.
Yeah, I agree with you. I don't know if you know, but he's releasing a song. I don't know when he's releasing, but he did some work with Cradle of Filth.
They're best friends apparently.
Yeah, yeah. So, you're doing a song for charity, so. I'm excited to see how that turns out. So that should be fun. You're a key figure in the band Cyhra, but you also have been a key figure in other projects and other bands. What does Cyhra give you that no other band, no other project has ever been able to give you?
I think it's brotherhood, as I said before. I mean, like, Cyhra is absolutely like a second family, and we have a really tight friendship, and we're not only playing in a band. I mean, like, most of the conversations that I have with the other members are not music related. We call each other about all other fucking things then we just end up playing in the same band. But I call them my best friends. And I think that is rare in bands nowadays, that you're actually having such a great foundation between the members, because all other bands that I've been in has always been around, like, yeah, on stage you look like your best friends, but then you don't talk to each other when you're off stage. And you know, I mean, like, I guess that is what work does to you. I mean, it's the same thing if you're working in the cubicle, I guess, that you're not friends with everyone, even though if you're sitting next to someone, that is what time does to you. But in Cyhra it's different. So I'm extremely happy to be part of this fantastic band.
And speaking of your bandmates, I'm going to see Alex in a couple of weeks, because Camelot is playing in Toronto mid-August. They're touring across North America. I'm also then going to see them at Prague Power, because I'm going to be at Prague Power in September. So
I saw that. Congratulations, by the way.
Yeah, yeah. So the question is, when are you guys playing at Prague Power?
Ask Glenn and ask, now I lost his name, the New York guy. What's his name? Now I feel bad. He's a friend of mine, but I just lost his name just because I'm angry at him. And I've been trying for us to come play Prague Power for so long, and I love the guys that are hosting it, and it's such a lovely festival, and I've been there several times. But I guess that our cycle has never really been perfect with when Prague Power is. So that is why. But I really hope that we could come there next year. I'm working hard on Glenn.
You should. I mean, I think it's time for you to pull any card that you have, any secret information that you might have in order to get that done. And that takes me to my next question, which is, can you give us a status update on the GoFundMe that you guys started up for the North American tour?
Absolutely. We have almost reached the goal, actually, and we are in the process of making the visas. So I guess that the visas are done now in like a month or two, which is fantastic. And from there, we can then start to work on touring the state. The situation is this, that everything has changed so dramatically now with visas and costs and whatever, you know, like everything has become so much more expensive. So it takes time. Unless you go for, you know, premium processing fees that can cost the double to have it done like quickly. You need to make sure that you have this 3-year-old visa before you start aiming to get a tour, because it's just impossible. If someone would reach out, you know, like 6 months ago and say, like, hey, guys, do you want to tour with us in June? We would not have been able to finish the visas. But now our visas is already or soon to be done. And now we could start to, you know, if someone calls us today, can you join us tomorrow? Then we could just go. So that is the benefit of that.
So we'll definitely, is this, am I hearing this correctly? Will we definitely see Cyhra back in North America in 2024?
Definitely. There could be tornadoes or a new pandemic or whatever. But so I won't promise that. But with 90% certainty during 24, absolutely.
I'm looking forward to it. It's been a long time. Do you realize the first tour you guys did, the first and only tour, was back in 2019?
I know. It's sick. It's sick. It feels like it was last year. But yeah. It is what it is. I can count the wrinkles in my forehead and realize that it was more than a year ago.
You guys already went through 4 mailmen since that tour.
Yeah.
It's been a lot of mailmen. When it comes to performing live, what's your favorite Cyhra song to do?
My favorite Cyhra song live? I Battle From Within is close to my own heart. And it's also really nice to see that. I always tell people, you know, to you know, drop all aggravations and, you know, misbelieves and whatever, and, you know, just even if they don't know the person next to them, I just tell them to hug them, because you never know what will happen tomorrow, and people always embrace my words in such a great way. And when I play that song, the audience is always there. They're singing, they're chanting, they're crying, they're hugging each other. It's a really powerful song to play live. And then, you know, ending a show with Out of My Life, where everyone knows the words and you know, putting them back into a happy place is also always fantastic.
Last question for you. As you said, touring these days is a lot more expensive after the pandemic, with bus costs, everything, visas, everything. Everything just got more expensive for you guys. When you're looking at a tour, where are you measuring the success of the tour? Is it based on the tickets that you guys are selling, the capacity of the shows, how much you guys are making on merch? Where do you see the bar for success these days for a band like Cyhra?
Hard question. I mean, like, obviously you want to play in front of as many people as possible, but right now, as time has changed, I mean, like, everything is so fully booked. So right now you're just happy to get tours, because even if you're sought after band, it's hard to get the tours in line because everything is fully booked all the time. It's really, really hard. And so right now I think that quantity of shows is probably a pretty good measurement stick on how popular a band is. But I don't know yet. We have been saying no to so many one-off shows lately that, because we live in three different countries, we need to, you know, package ourselves together and do touring our main priority, so that we're at the same bus traveling from place to place instead of doing weekend shows, you know, like one show in Sweden, one in Portugal, one in Germany, whatever, because it costs too much. As you said, it costs too much money. You cannot do that anymore. You need to make sure that you pack the shows together and pack them as tours. Otherwise, it's economically not viable.
It's a crazy world out there. The world has completely changed for musicians like yourself and for bands that want to hit the road and tour. Jake, thank you very much for your time, man. Always a pleasure to talk to you. I'm looking forward to seeing you in person in Toronto during a North American tour. I'm just looking forward to just seeing your face and squeezing and hugging you and hanging out with you. And I mean, it's been an incredible long time since I've seen you in person. So looking forward to this.
I do the same. I do the same. I can't wait. And I hope it's going to be sooner than later.
I'm keeping my fingers crossed. And let's see some positive vibes about Croc Power. When I'm there in September, I'll keep, you know what? Not only I keep mentioning the band's name, I'll wear my Cyhra t-shirt on one of the days as well.
And here's the thing. There's going to come a new package for you before that. So, you know, watch out in your mailbox, my friend. Oh,
all right. So maybe I'll wear more than just one Cyhra shirt while I'm there. So maybe I'll wear Cyhra shirts for a couple of days in a row. So maybe that's what I'm going to do.
Oh, so you're the kind of guy that changes shirts. That's great.
Oh, yeah. Like every day I'll wear a different one. Like, and what I'm planning on doing is wearing shirts from bands that I love, that I'm friends with. So that way I get to promote the band while I'm there wearing the shirt. Subliminal messages. You know what I'm saying? Like subliminal messages.
Yeah, absolutely. That's great. That's great. I really appreciate that. That means a lot to us.
That's what I'm going to try to do. Thank you very much for your time, man. All the best. All the best with the release. And we'll see you soon.
Thank you so much. Have a great evening, man.
Bye.